Okay. First, thank you, Caleb. It's wonderful being back here again. It's, you know, I don't know about you all, but I think I kind of like him. He asked me, you know, he's asked me before about coming and doing a talk. I wasn't able to do it then, but I was able to come now, and it's my pleasure to do so. I've had a wonderful time just like being a part of this community, being able to do the show years ago, and coming back, you know, at various times, just seeing other people's work and just celebrating the shows that are here. Let's see. And thank you all for coming out to this talk. I appreciate the fact that you take out of your time to come and hear me blab on a little bit. So where do I start? Let's start here. Let's just go forward. This, and during the last show here, I had this large piece, I believe, was here, and we actually fit it in this room. And a lot of people know me for my large-scale quilt paintings. But today, I'm not going to show any quilt pieces. It's mostly going to be figurative work. But what you will see is that there's a tie and there's a connection between quilts and the figures and whatever else I show you. I want to talk a little bit about process. And really, like, walking things down, like the process of working on work, and how, personally, ideas of family, ideas of the faith, and how I deal with community. And even in the quilt, there was that idea. That's why I wanted to start with it first. There was ideas of family with the quilt. My grandmother was a quilter. There was a communal aspect to it. Many of those quilters were strong women of faith. So I wanted to start with this. These were very similar, although you have the groups that we have here. Are from the are the prints. The groups that's there are they were a part of the prints that didn't make it. What you call that group? So I was able to sort of play, like I put a little bit of color on them because they were sort of experimental. And there's one that you're missing. You all can endeavor to get that. That center, that headpiece, the self-portrait that was there. But I started many years back trying to deal with the black family, African-American family. And by dealing with the black family, I'm dealing with family. And it's through multiple means that I really try to deal with that. So I'm gonna go through, but I wanted to show this one first because there's a lot of things involved. Like you see this picture, you don't have any. On some pieces, I do writings and different things, but you just kind of see these different individuals of a family, them stacked side by side, and you're looking at them individually, but collectively, they make a family. And, you know, there was one called the American son, American daughter, American mom, American dad, American baby. And it was about looking at that and thinking about being American in the midst of a culture that many times could possibly make you feel un-American. Here's the same sort of thing in play with sketchbook sketches, and these pictures were all put together as well to hang side by side. But I was in the midst of really like studying how to do these portraits where you do them individually and then you put them together for a collective piece. And it's about sort of emphasizing both individuality and the group of a family. And acknowledging both of those things, the individuality of each person, but collectively put together what that looks like and how to express thoughts about family with those groupings. This was a more recent group called the Huckabees. And with this group, actually some of the bigger portraits are pretty big. I think like the tallest one might be 6 feet tall. And this was about kind of discovering and researching family. You look on there and you see like, on the one of them is a self-portrait to the far left, and then there's my father and mother. And the other group of Huckabees are a group of Huckabees that I met in town who has the same name and has the same spelling of their name. And I had been knowing them, knowing about them for many years through the newspaper, but never having met them. And this project was about sort of meeting them and coming together and finding out, if at all, our paths cross. And so we're there on that, all sitting on that shelf together as a group. And for some details of that, you can kind of see all of the paintings, the drawings. One of the things that's real sort of always a thing in my work is the touch. And it always has a little bit of an expressive sense of touch to it. And I really try to do things with that. Like I feel like that sense of touch, it's a little bit of visual language. Here's some other portraits. This one was called Sonadores. Literally at the time when I was creating this portrait, the family they couldn't get their name at the time because there was a lot of issues in our area with people being deported. The children here are dreamers, and there was a lot of pressure on some of the dreamers at the time that about deportation and different things. But this is a family, and we see the husband and wife in the middle, and their two children, and there is the whole ideal of their individuality in the middle of their collective unity. And I don't know what you would call me in terms of an artist. Like sometimes people, the work looks like a traditional painter. Like you can see a Velázquez kind of influence, but other times you look at that and you might think Lucian Freud, but I don't know, like you judge. More recently on some of the groups, the work is not just paintings going together, but they're paintings and sculptures. Another thing that entered back into the work of figures, this was already, for those of you all who saw the show here of quilts, some of the quilts you saw, they were sort of abstracted quilts, and some were representational quilts. Well, nobody had seen any abstracted figures that I had done, although I had done them, usually small scale. But in here, you start to see the some of the abstracted figures standing with some of the representational figures. And again, it's about connectivity, about sort of uniting people united, although they're separated. And the whole ideal of a sculpture and a painted figure sort of standing together in a united way. It's like people from very different places, and usually that's what it is. The sculpture is a cousin, and there's the figure, and they're wearing memorial t-shirts. It's hard to kind of see. Oh. And the figure in the background is wearing a memorial t-shirt, and the figure in the front has a similar t-shirt, but there's no one in it. It's just the square that goes on the shirt. And one of the things you all have to excuse me with the images. So usually I have all the information should be on the fly, so what size it is, what the medium is. I don't have that on these. Excuse me for that. Some of the later images will have some of that information. The piece is about 6 feet tall. The painting is the sculpture. She must be about half that height. You look at it. And it's oil on canvas, and then the sculpture is paper mache. Here's some more of those images. With this work, this one is called Amen. And the one before, I'm trying to remember the name of that piece, it was called I'll remember it later. This one's called Amen or Amen. And you see the two figures wearing the shirts, and then the figure standing in the front. And there's an interplay between the painted space and the actual, the real space and the sculpture. And so it's really about family being connected even after death. So again, it's just the ideal of thinking about family and thinking deeply about it. This one actually right now is at the, if you take a trip to DC anytime soon, anytime before the end of the year, I have an entire room at the National Portrait Gallery, and it's a show called Kinship. So each artist has a room in that show, and you would see this piece there. I wanted to show you all a little in the studio, what's going on. You see the pieces, but let's look behind the scene, and this is what you'll see behind the scene, piece being made. So that's my son standing there that I'm sculpting from. And this is what the studio looks like in the middle of work. Another shot. Those are my two daughters. And really the three sculptures you see there is the three of them. And my daughter is there. She's helping me create the paper mache. And why is that important? I don't know. I think it's just something to note that that's what goes into the process. It's like the process, it's important because so much time is spent making art that process has in it a little bit of the relationship with the figures are somewhat important. In other words, in that paint, in the piece you saw the two figures in the piece looking down at the sculptural piece. And there was a lady holding a sonogram. And all of the people I know in the painting, but maybe you'd never know that I knew in the painting. And the figure standing up is representing a figure. And I guess maybe it's more for me than for the audience is the figure he's representing is his brother. So it's sort of important that process has a bit of life to it too. This was a group of works that I was working on about family and a little bit about loss. And this was the first iteration of it. And a number of these next slides, you'll see a process of coming to, how do you come to resolve an image or how it should work? It happens in a process. Sometimes you don't know and you try it this way and you try it another way. These pieces are a lot larger. They're 8 feet tall. And how wide are they? Maybe they're like maybe 4x8 or 5x8 or something like that. But maybe it's probably more like 6x8. I did this same thing again. Like I switched the pieces around and I kept working on the different heads and I even repainted. Let me see if I can, yeah. I did a whole nother painting of her. I'll take you back. So this was the first one. And then I painted her again on this one. But by switching around the pieces and then clustering them together, it gives a really very different effect. And you know, it's funny too, because often I've shown these peaches clustered together like this, and the idea, people like to pull them apart, like it's kind of something that people think, you're covering up a wonderfully painted canvas. But that's a little bit of the ideal, is that really it doesn't cover too much up. Number one, like if you look at that, that's not anything important really covered up. But it does give the sense of like huddled together or grouped together, or, and it makes it more than what it was individually. So here are some of those portraits individually. You can kind of see, that's Hallie, that's my daughter. The paint gets pretty thick on some of these. That's Letitia. That's my portrait. Okay, so going from groups and families, and the whole idea was exploring family, right? Because I was dealing with like family portrait, expressive kind of sense of family, like in some of the etchings, family in the midst of a certain environment, family with loss, a family connected through loss. Dealing more widely with community now, this piece is a sort of portrait of a snippet of the community that I grew up in. And I like looking at it and really seeing it put together. Let me see how to do that. How you do that, Kayla? You can kind of, this was a show at the Amon Carter. In these works, the whole idea was to walk around the community, find people who might be interested in getting like a sketch done of them and talking to them. And I include some snippets from our conversation in those talks. I started with family who lived in the community, and then I branched out to other people. And I just included one, but part of the idea was listening to just everyday people who maybe their voices, the voices of this particular community in Highland Hills, is not one that's often heard unless there's something noteworthy for the news. And in order for it to be noteworthy for the evening news, it has to be some kind of like, you know, something horrible happened there. But just to walk around and to talk to people and to see what's on their mind, well, that's a different story. And maybe a lot of times that's not newsworthy, but it is the truth. Like it's what in any old day you start walking around and talking. And that was what was important to me, is the moments, the times that are not important. I think they are important. And I could go through and read that, but I'll keep pushing. So it started off with sketches, and then I took the sketches into the, I did a residency at Brandywine where we transformed the sketches into lithographs. And so this is the lithographs. And that, it just involves drawing on the plates again, and then layering those images. In the dealing with communities, I also got the opportunity when there was someone who came from Philadelphia and saw the work, and they wanted me to do a project at this hospital there in Philadelphia. And so I looked at the hospital as a type of community. and decided to come in and kind of do a similar project like the 99%, but in the hospital where I get to talk to doctors and people who work there and some of the patients and former patients, just to get a sense of the hospital community and to see what a contemporary artist listening and drawing could bring to this, to the idea. And so that's what you see there. I brought this lady with me. She's a singer. And there was a videographer that came, and we created this wonderful present. I created some works, drawings, ink drawings, like this one. And also, we did a wonderful presentation where the singer was singing songs that different people reminded her of with some of their statements. And it was a great opportunity for collaboration with some other types of artists and for practice in listening to people. And I want to show y'all, take y'all behind the scenes to see what that's like also, so that you can, I want you to kind of get to see how the process ends up flowing onto, into the work, okay? So this is Mr. Williams, and you see his hands? That's what I was drawing. He was talking, he was moving, but I'm trying to capture him. But I want you to hear him. So I'm gonna play the part from the presentation that we did. So Mr. Williams, he said this one thing, and you're gonna find this through all of the, I found it through all of the people, stuff I've talked to. He said, I come from a family where people like to laugh, and that's good medicine. And we all know that, but when you practice it, you'll find out the truth of that statement.
Probably about 6 weeks ago, I texted you.
This is Mr. Charles Williams.
Well, I'm excited to introduce yourself. How are you doing?
Insulin at that time. Mm. And I sit up there and I actually cried like a baby because this insulin thing. I seen my mother go through it. This day my mother was living, I sit with her for the whole day. For some reason, I didn't go to church. I sit with her and watched her. Because the hospital, the doctor sent her home statement on the weekend. And he said, if she make it through the weekend, you can bring her back Monday. So I told the doctor, I said, Doc, he's sending her home to die. If what can I do over the weekend that you can pass away? And even today, I had the feeling that if I had to stay, this is only me talking, if I had to stay there selfishly just to keep her alive, I think about that even now, you know. And but she was an amazing woman. She died at age 65, you know. And everybody in my family didn't reach 66. Every person in my family died in their 60s.
Wow.
You know, every person in my family died in their 60s.
Wow.
And so, I mean, yeah, in the 60s, like, didn't go past 65. And my mother died at 65, my father died at 65, and all my aunts have died about 65. And the funny thing about it, I was 64, 11 months and 29 days. I didn't want to go to sleep. I didn't want to go to sleep. But God brought me through.
Yeah.
So I'm 80 years old now.
Oh, wow.
You know, so God's been grateful. Yeah, I'm 80 years old now.
So that's a little snippet from like a drawing session with somebody. Somebody's talking and you sort of work with them. They are talking, I kind of work and figure out certain things, a way of getting them. Sometimes they're silent and I can get them, you know, one way or another. You know, I figured out how to do it, but it's important, like that whole engagement with an actual person and listening to that person. And if you would have saw just the drawing that I was showing you and what he said, it kind of didn't come through. He said, laughter was like medicine to people. And that's, you saw a lot of that going on. He was like, his whole family died at 65, which is like the continuing work of this particular hospital helped him to live a lot longer than that. But he was like, when I got 64 and I knew my birthday was coming up, I was scared. I didn't want to go to sleep because everybody died at 65. So, you know, I guess I'll keep going, but working with community is sort of a push out from, it's people-centered, and you'll see more of me dealing with that. This is another way, during the pandemic, there was a lot going on during that time. And some folks reached out to me about like street murals, which has never been my thing. But it seemed like something, like it would be great to do something to because at the time there was a lot, if y'all remember, it was like a tidal wave of stuff. The pandemic was going on, and then there was all these issues with the George Floyd case was going on, and there was all these movements that were sweeping around. And so I decided to do this large street mural in Fort Worth on Main Street, just as a way of touching the community, dealing with the community, and really making a statement on the subject. And the way I chose to deal with it is to really use people's signature as drawing. And that all of the drawing wasn't my hand, it was my design, but everybody's unique signature that made up the marks on the end and the racism. The end and the now. And it was a community project, and it took participation for people to basically sign to this idea that, you know, it's high time for that. This is just the process of it. You see all the people coming out. There's volunteers who are helping people to line up to know where to sign their names. And there's all the names that are on there and people doing it in their own handwriting. Very different. I've never done anything like it since. But it was a way for me to engage the period, engage that time in a way that felt meaningful to me at the time. And this will just kind of give you a sense of what that whole mural looks like from street moving up. And there was something about the process of this that was somewhat healing for the Tarrant County community. People's participation, people being able to put their name in it and sign to it and just make this statement. The community consists not only of the people in the various communities around the city, who helped with the end racism, or the families in neighborhoods, you know, around the city. But there are the well-known people of the area. Like, this is a portrait of Miss Opal. And I've done a number of portraits of Miss Opal, probably five. And one of them has been acquired by the National Portrait Gallery. And I'll probably be going up there in November for their new acquisitions, the unveiling of their new acquisitions. But this is a portrait of Miss Opal that I did that was pastels. And just, Miss Opal is now a national figure, nationally known. But for me, I've been knowing her ever since I was a little kid, from just around the community. She used to do have the Juneteenth, it was like a committee or with a little building on the corner of Evans and Rosedale. And they would get together and tell people about Juneteenth. And they've been promoting Juneteenth for many, many years before, during the pandemic, the push was made to make it into a national holiday, and it actually happened. There's also this portrait. Many of y'all know, people always ask me. I taught former President George Bush how to paint. But this is a portrait I did of him. And part of that, what was important about that portrait, the former president wanted to know how to paint, and he had already started painting. And it's the portrait is called George Walker Bush. Everybody knows him as George W. Bush. Nobody knows what the W meant, what the name was. And I included the name Walker just as a way of saying that maybe there's parts of people that, like, we don't know. You know what you know, like, you've seen all that you've seen, but in this portrait, he doesn't have a suit on, there's no tie on, it's a t-shirt. Another type of portrait that happened is this one. And this is it's not a real portrait, but it is. I was doing this piece about a man named Fred Rouse, and he's the only person who was listed in Tarrant County as being lynched in our area. And they came to me about the idea of a portrait of Fred, but there's no images of Fred Rouse. And so this is kind of what I came up with initially. I'll let you watch it.
Igniting the flame to burn the darkness down into the womb. The light goes, igniting the flame.
Igniting the flame.
Igniting the flame into the womb.
Where I actually started off with that piece is not here in town, but I was at a museum called, I believe it's called the National Museum of Peace and Justice. Is that what it's called? It's in Alabama, and they made this large memorial for lynching, and I was going through, and they have every county in the U.S., the people who they know who were lynched in that county. And so as I went through, I looked for who was on the panel for Tarrant County. And I found the panel, and there was one name on there, was Fred Rouse. And, you know, I just took note of it. And after I got back to town, it wasn't too long after that I met a guy who was trying to put together something to remember Fred, like a kind of tour. And they ended up calling it the Fort Worth lynching tour, but they wanted people to think about, like, stages of occurrences that happen that lead to something like that. And they asked me if I could do a portrait that could go on the app. And so this was my response. After this, after they started that initial movement, I started this. There was actually a young man in town who found out, everybody kept asking him, was he relation to Fred Rouse? Because his name was Fred Rouse III. And he didn't know. And he discovered that Fred Rouse was his grandfather. And story goes, he went on to be in a lot of, he did a lot of leadership around the area, and this is all recent. They've started a Fred Rouse Memorial Park. There's been a Fred Rouse Day that they started, and they were so in Fort Worth, there was this large building that used to be a headquarters for the KKK, and it's embossed in the side of the building, but nobody ever saw it because they always put up signs on it. And but they're transforming that sign now. It's a project called the 1012, Transform 1012, and it's turning into the Fred Rouse Center for Arts and Healing. And this drawing, I've recently redid it. And the new one, so the old one, the idea was that I started with an older fella, older person, who Fred could have looked like this, and the person kept getting younger. He could have looked like this. The last figure on there was my son. He could have looked like this. And the whole idea was that Fred could have looked like anybody that was in the wrong place at the wrong time. And so it's just this transformation of people, and written on the shirt was contemplating Fred Rouse. That kept sort of being written in and then swiped out. And it was an ideal of like contemplating the whole idea of who was he and what he looks like. But in the new drawing, it's just like this, done the exact same, but I got to meet Fred Rouse III. And it just so happened that he had pictures of his father, Fred Rouse II, but there are still no pictures of Fred Rouse. And so the drawing starts with a blur, and then I start with Fred Rouse II, and I swipe him out, and then there's Fred Rouse III, and I swipe him out, and it just so happened he had a son, Fred Rouse IV. So Fred Rouse, it goes through the Fred Rouses in the new drawing. So here's the, I'm coming down the line here, so I'm gonna show you all a few pictures starting at Big Mama's house. Big Mama was my grandmother. And it's gonna be, you'll see the movement of just me as a painter into like dealing with art as project. So these were paintings that I did at my grandmother's home, Big Mama's house, you could say. And there's my grandmother, she's there in red. And when I got back from school, I started doing this series of pictures around Big Mama's house. I would start with her and then branch out to other members of the household. This was a piece I did right after she passed away. It was just her empty room, empty bed, empty space there at the house. And later, I got to get the house from the family. And so I kept painting the empty rooms. And I started taking the stuff down, taking the carpet up, taking the stuff off the walls. Some of the furniture and stuff was still around. And I kept painting the house. And over time, I kept working with the house. So it started with paintings of her in her room, and then paintings of family who were around the house. And you'll see some more of those later. Paintings of the house with empty rooms. But the question is, how could this place that it was my grandmother's home, it was a place for family, it was a place where people were welcomed in the community, it was a place where people felt, it was a home, but it was also a place that was very inviting, and a lot of stuff happened there. Here's a picture outside the house looking at the front early on. Well, later, I start working at turning that place into something, maybe a space that could engage the community and be a lively part of the community. And here's the question, can a space be art? We start working on the ideal of transforming it into a collaborative art space. Me and my wife, Leticia, And we started reaching out and we started pulling and seeing who could be a part of it. And now it is this place called Kinfolk House. And Kinfolk House is a collaborative art space that engages the community through art. And I hope is a creative hub in the Polytechnic community. And it is. These were some of those works, portraits I did of people who knew the house and was around the house. The first show we did, I showed some of these portraits that I had done of people and wearing their memorial t-shirts. So the people on the t-shirts would have known the place, and the people wearing the t-shirts also know the place. And they're on the wall in the house. And I wanted to start that way just by starting where I was gonna kick things off. I hadn't showed my work there ever since, but Leticia and I were the first, were part of the first show. We kept expanding, making partnerships, engaging both the local community and area and then the larger community. This was a outreach kind of project we did in the mall. Like we printed up this stuff because we wanted to show what Kinfolk House was about, and we sort of moved about. We've done things at theaters, we've done things at like the Harambe Festival, and we partner with different places. We moved this thing, this little viewing into North Park. And it was just a way of like telling people what's going on in Poly with Kinfolk. And this will walk you through this presentation. We've done some great projects there. Some of what you saw, some of the artists. So we'll have three artists. One is a local artist, one is a regional, and one is a national. We pair them together in looking at their work. We'll do a call at a certain point of year, and we're looking for local artists who we want to build around. And then once we find our local artists, we pair them with a regional and a national artist. We look for ways in which they can collaborate. Like there's a whole talking going on. And we also just like collaborate with people in the community, singers, actors, whatever. And we've had some wonderful projects. One of our artists, she went around and visited mom and pop stores in the area, and she did these large woodcuts of portraits of the owners and showed them in the house, and it, you know, and it drew all of them in, them and their families and people. We had a fashion designer paired up with some visual artists and with art and fashion. It's been a great run, and up until this very point, I think coming up, one of our artists. So each artist, they come up with some kind of engagement that they want to do, and we sort of empower them to do it, and we just have conversations about it, and it's always, they're wonderful. Like they just finished one with weaving that was great that they did in the backyard. One of our artists, he was like, even one of our artists now, the next thing he's going to do, he wants to, we're putting out tables, and people, because they are dealing with games and the importance of games in our lives. And so he paints on Pokemon cards, and but his project, they're putting out tables and they're inviting people over. We're gonna have music and games, and you know, people looking at the art. They get to talk to the artist, but they also are sort of engaging each other through these different games. Here is Brandy. Brandy Pace is one of the singers in the area, and I don't know if y'all know her or not. She's sort of jazz folk singer. And here's Brandy singing at the house on one engagement. You know, there's whole ideas. Artists, Rick Lowe used to, he's the artist for Project Grow House, and he talks about art as social sculpture, the whole idea of art as social sculpture. I don't know if I've been able to get my head around that or not. But what I do think is that something a little closer to home, the Magic School Bus. There's a cartoon you all might know called the Magic School Bus. And maybe I'm just, if there were little kids, they might not know it, but y'all know the Magic School Bus. All right. So it's this idea of this bus. And the kids, the bus takes them wherever learning is. Like the bus will transform into like a spaceship and take them out of space. And they learn all about space, traveling on the bus to outer space. Or the bus will turn into some kind of little like micro thing and go down somebody's throat, and you learn all about the inner workings of the body and diseases through this journey down the throat. And the bus does whatever transformation it takes to bring about learning in the kids. And that's kind of how I see the house. It's this transformative space that will transform and do, respond to the artists and do in the community, everything, whatever, in order to bring about culture, bring about learning, bring about transformation. I think that's it.
Well, as someone who's been to Kinfolk many times, it is worth the trip, and it truly is a special place. So. But we'll take a few questions. If anyone has any questions, just raise your hand. Cedric will be glad to answer. Yes.
So I'm curious, over the whole sort of oeuvre and what you've shown today, there's this recurrent idea of the memorial, and not in, you know, the elevated person of status, but the every man, every person of the community. I wonder if you can address that and how these sort of layering of even a memorial to time, like the pictures of Big Mama's house, play in that work, in your work.
So let me understand it right. Just addressing the ideal of like memorial to place and time?
Yeah, it seems very consistent in what I'm seeing with the laying of generations.
You know, so there's the ideal of remembering. There's the ideal of not forgetting and paying homage to people, really giving dignity to people and the worth of people, no matter who they are. You know, I threw those two portraits in of some very famous people to show that even famous people are just people. And so really the work is about like, the importance, the worth of human life, the dignity of every person, especially those coming from my perspective that don't get the voice, that doesn't get to be seen, that doesn't, you know, there's always a little bit, I have a little bit more of a push in that direction, simply be probably because of my own background and upbringing.
Can I ask one follow-up?
Okay.
And the community drawings that you did where you were working with your own neighborhood,
yeah.
Did you glean any perspectives of your neighborhood that you had never thought about from this broader community?
Many. During that project, really, I learned a lot. And I haven't, the other project with the hospital was an offshoot of that. And right now I'm doing a project where, very similar thing. I just came back from Mexico. I was there for 4 months drawing a community there. And that project led me to think differently about art. It led me to be more open to what can happen when we listen. I had never used art as a tool to listen. And when I did that, it transformed the art that I do. It also opened up ideas of how to engage communities creatively. I wasn't able to do it in that project, but I saw opportunities to do it that later, as I go along, I'm trying to explore that engagement. And if art can be everything that objects of contemplation can be, and then be more than that, can be activism and engagement, and even, you know, like there's a number of artists now who are socially engaged artists, what they call them, and it's art that deals with engaging the society in different ways and engaging people. And I think some of those projects can do both. I think they can literally be just the art that makes us think about these ideas, but I also think that they can be art that is transformative, that is active, and that engages. So, yeah.
Anyone else?
Hi. KinfolkHouse is so wonderful and inspiring. If you were to advise someone on how to start a homegrown art space, community space, what would you say are the biggest challenges?
You know, like, I think first, you want to start with something that is very, I want to say, either natural for the person or something that I don't know how to say natural for the person, but I'm thinking, like, you know, let me give an example. So before Kinfolk House, there was another house, art space, that is by a sort of mentor of mine named Dr. Eddie McAnthony. That house is called McAnthony's Multicultural Studio and Gallery. It's on a street called Berry Street in Fort Worth. And there, the artist transformed a house to his studio and to a gallery. Now, Dr. McAnthony is in his 80s now, and he's a student of John Biggers. You'll see his work in this room down toward the end. He's a student of John Biggers, but the reason he opened the house to begin with was that during a certain time in Fort Worth history, it was hard for people to accept his work, and he wanted, you know, to show his work in some of the galleries. It was kind of hard dealing with him, so he decided, I'll open my own gallery. And everybody told him, open your gallery up in the Arts District. That way, you know, a lot of people can see it. And he said, no, I'm going to open it up right here in this neighborhood. I'm going to do my work right here because I think I can do it well enough that people will come from all over into this neighborhood to see it. And when he started doing his own work, you know, that's very natural, right? An artist needing a place to do their work and wanting to show it. But then he found that there was a lot of other artists who were running into the same issues that he should show in his space. And so he started showing their work as well. Well, that's just a natural flow of what he was gonna do, what he should do. It wasn't as hard to do because he was doing it anyway. He just, as he moved along, he found ways to make it more like professional, to get the proper allowances to do it, but that it was a natural that he should do it, you know, It was, and so when you find something that's like, hey, we should do that, like, let's do it. This not gonna take, what it takes is we're willing to do it. It's not gonna, I don't wanna say it's not gonna kill us, but it's just, you got good reason to do it. And so when you start with something like that, then everything else is like problem solving. What do we need? What kind of allowances do we need here so that we don't get shut down? And how do we become a nonprofit organization so that we can receive, if we need to, or should we become nonprofit, or should we be, you know, some other designation? And when you find out, then you say, okay, well, what are the steps that it takes to do that? One big thing somebody's gonna always run into, the first thing would be natural, is funding. How are you gonna fund this place and keep it running, you know? But you look for ways, like you should have a plan of that. Like I would say for anybody, don't just jump out there and don't think about it. Be like, I'm just gonna do it, we'll figure it out. You know, like have a plan, think about it. Having really thought about it, it doesn't have to fit any kind of way that anybody has ever done it. But do have a plan for it, and make sure that plan, as much as possible, is solid. Because even with a solid plan, when you try to run it, you're gonna find all of the stuff that you didn't know was there. So those are the things, is really start out with a purpose that you feel really called to do, or it feels really natural to do, and then, you know, as you go into it, think about, you know, practically think about how you want to fund it, how we're going to fund it. Is it going to be a not-for-profit and we go after grants to support this? Is it going to be some other funded? And, you know, one way of approaching that is to look at how other people have done it. Like, I was looking around before I started Kinfolk. How did Rick Lowe do this with Project Row House? How did Theaster Gates do his thing up there in Chicago when he put it together? How did, you know, this place do its thing? I called some people who had done like house art spaces in Fort Worth. Hey, how did that go? What did you do? You know, so that I would get a good idea about what I should do.
Yes.
Yeah, so what advice would I have for young artists? Wow, I got a lot of advice for young artists, but where do I start? part of it, you know, there's the art that you make. In the art that you make, it's probably not, I don't care what anybody says, it's probably not just for you. If the art is just for you and just for you alone, then you don't need anybody else to do that. Like, you can do that without another person and it's just for you. But if the art is going out there in the world, you know, my advice is to always seek wise advice. Like, get good critique on your work so you know all of the subjects that surround the work. And you can like run it by people to see if what you're trying to get over and what you are, if the work is evoking what you think it is. Because many times we can think a work is doing this and it's not. And so get a lot of critique by different types of people. And then that's on the one hand. Getting a consistent sort of being able to work on the work with a kind of consistency is important. And sometimes that takes fighting. How do I make a living while I'm pursuing this career? Because usually you don't start with just like the whole world knowing you and everybody's lining up to buy your work, right? Usually nobody knows you, and you have to work your way up. And so you have to make it and create work and constantly get it out there. Now, once you've dealt with, like, you started with something, you got a little something, you know a little bit about your work and where you're at and what you're doing, and you're working that out. The other end of that is constantly working to find ways of building yourself up as an artist. That is seeking opportunities to show your work, seeking partners to work with you, seeking opportunities, awards that you can apply for, seeking ways to sort of get yourself out there. And probably in this generation, this day and age, a big part of that is how do you deal with digital technology? How do you deal with social media? I think there's some today that, like, probably today, people will most likely see your work first online before they see it in person. So understand a little bit about, like, how to navigate in that area too, and that'll be important. You're welcome.
Any others? Well, thank you, Cedric.